Have you ever gone through something difficult that you felt like changed you, like it left a mark that just wouldn't go away? That's the reality of trauma. It doesn't just affect your emotions, it actually reshapes your brain. But here's the hopeful part. That reshaping goes both ways. I'm Dr. Tracey Marks, a psychiatrist, and I help you strengthen your mind, fortify your brain, and build resilience. In today's video, we're going to look at what trauma really does to the brain and how healing is not only possible, but can lead to what's called post-traumatic growth. We'll talk about the science behind how the brain recovers and the kind of tools that help rewire the trauma response. This video is part of a module on overcoming setbacks that's part of my resilience series. And so far, we've talked about bouncing back from disruption and learning from mistakes. Now we're going deeper to the moments that feel like they altered who you are. Before we dive into the brain, it's helpful to understand what trauma actually is. Trauma isn't just about having a bad experience or a very upsetting experience. It's when something overwhelms your nervous system's ability to cope, leaving you feeling helpless, unsafe, or like you've completely lost control. Let's begin with what's happening in your brain when you experience trauma. When you go through a traumatic experience, especially one that involves fear, helplessness, or a threat to your safety, your brain goes into survival mode. And that survival mode leaves fingerprints on three major areas of your brain. First, the amygdala. This is your brain's threat detector. It's like a smoke alarm that sounds the alarm or sounds an alert when something dangerous is happening. During trauma, the amygdala becomes hyperactive. And long after the event is over, it can stay that way. And that's why people who've experienced trauma often feel constantly on edge or overreact to things that seem minor to other people. Their alarm system becomes overly sensitive. Next is the hippocampus. This area helps form and organize memories, but trauma disrupts this process. Instead of a clear, cohesive memory, you get fragmented, disorganized impressions. And some details may be missing entirely, while others, like sound or a smell that was associated, can be overwhelmingly vivid. And this is why trauma memories often feel fragmented, like scattered puzzle pieces that don't fit together. Over time, chronic stress can even shrink the hippocampus, which is one reason why memory problems are common after trauma. Then there's the prefrontal cortex, and this is your brain's CEO, the part responsible for logic, planning, and emotional regulation. When you're in survival mode, your prefrontal cortex takes a back seat. The amygdala says, "We're in danger." And the prefrontal cortex is temporarily shut down so that you can react fast. But after trauma, this imbalance can become chronic. You may struggle to focus, regulate your emotions, or make decisions because your thinking brain isn't fully online. So what does all this mean? It means trauma isn't just psychological, it's neurological. It changes the way your brain functions. And that's why trauma recovery isn't just about moving on. It's about helping your brain feel safe again and rewiring those disrupted pathways. And here's something important to remember. These aren't signs that you're broken. These are survival adaptations. Your brain responded the way that it was designed to protect you in the moment. And these same mechanisms that helped you survive can also help you recover. And your brain has the ability to do exactly that. Thanks to neuroplasticity, your brain's ability to rewire and adapt, trauma doesn't have to be the end of your story. Healing is possible, not just emotionally, but physically in your brain. Trauma reorganizes your brain for survival. Healing is simply reorganizing it again for safety, connection, and thriving. When you create experiences of safety, stability, and emotional regulation, your brain begins to form new associations. And those new experiences help quiet the overactive amygdala, rebuild memory structures in the hippocampus, and bring your prefrontal cortex back online. In fact, one of the most important ingredients in trauma recovery is predictability. And that might sound simple, but routines and a sense of structure tell your nervous system you're not in danger anymore. You can let your guard down. Another key element is emotional safety, not just in your environment, but in your internal world. That means learning to relate to your thoughts and emotions in a different way. Instead of pushing away distressing feelings, you learn to acknowledge them, tolerate them, and respond with compassion. And this is where the healing really begins, not by forgetting what happened, but by changing how your brain responds to the memory. So how do you create these healing experiences? Let's talk about specific tools and practices that help. There isn't one right way to heal from trauma, but there are several powerful tools that can support brain-based recovery. One of the most studied is mindfulness. Practicing mindfulness helps you stay grounded in the present moment, which is essential for people who feel stuck in the past. When you're mindful, you're training your prefrontal cortex to stay online. You're learning to observe your inner experience without being overwhelmed by it. Another evidence-based approach is EMDR, which stands for eye movement desensitization and reprocessing. EMDR uses bilateral stimulation, like guided eye movements, while at the same time you recall aspects of the traumatic memory. That process helps the brain reprocess the memory so that it's no longer emotionally triggering. Think of it as organizing a messy file cabinet. Your brain still has the memory, but it's stored in a way that doesn't hijack your system. Somatic therapies are also incredibly effective. These approaches focus on the body's role in trauma. When you've been through something overwhelming, that stress doesn't just live in your thoughts, it lives in your body. Somatic tools like grounding exercises, breath work, and body scanning can help release that stored tension and rebuild a sense of safety from the inside out. And then there's the power of relationships. Trauma often involves isolation or disconnection. Safe, supportive relationships are one of the most powerful ways to heal. And this is called co-regulation, when your nervous system syncs up with someone else's calm presence. It's why therapy, support groups, and emotionally safe relationships can be so healing. You don't have to do it alone. In fact, your brain isn't wired to do it alone. Not everyone who goes through trauma experiences growth from it, but it is possible, and it's more common than you might think. Post-traumatic growth is the idea that you can come out of a traumatic experience with new strengths or insights. It doesn't mean the trauma was a good thing. It just means that as you heal, you may discover ways that it changed you for the better. People who experience post-traumatic growth often report things like a deeper appreciation for life, stronger relationships and increased empathy, or a greater sense of purpose or personal strength. Another thing they may experience is spiritual growth, or it may align them with new priorities. What's happening here is the brain isn't just healing, it's reorganizing itself in a more resilient way. From a neuroscience perspective, growth happens as your brain rewires the circuits involved in purpose, connection, and emotional strength. And this is what we call adaptive neuroplasticity. You're not just recovering to your baseline level, you're developing new coping strategies, emotional insight, and cognitive flexibility. And here's something important to remember. Post-traumatic growth is not the opposite of suffering. You can still have symptoms, you can still struggle, and still grow at the same time. Growth doesn't mean everything is fine. It means you found a way to carry your experience with more strength and perspective. So, how do you support that kind of growth? By staying engaged in the healing process, and by continuing to build tools that regulate your nervous system, and by seeking connection, by giving meaning to your story on your own terms. If there's one thing that I want you to take away from this video, it's this. Healing happens through repetition of safety, not through forced change. That means creating small, regular inputs that tell your brain, "I'm okay now." This could be something as simple as a daily grounding ritual, like standing barefoot on the ground, breathing deeply for a few minutes, or repeating a calming phrase. It could be writing in a journal or using my Essential Tools card deck to process your emotions when they feel overwhelming. It could be scheduling time with a friend who makes you feel seen, or setting boundaries that help you feel more emotionally safe. These healing inputs are like nutrients for your nervous system. The more consistently you feed your brain those experiences of regulation and safety, the more it adapts. And over time, your default wiring begins to shift from survival mode to resilience mode. So let's recap. Trauma changes the brain, but because of neuroplasticity, healing is possible. Not only healing, but growth. Your brain has an incredible ability to recover, reorganize, and thrive. In our next video, we'll look at what happens when trauma or failure gets tangled up with shame and how shame can short-circuit your ability to learn from failure. I'll show you how to move from self-judgment to strategy so you can fail smarter and come back stronger. If this video resonated with you, I'd love to hear in the comments. What's one practice that helps you feel safe or grounded? And if you haven't already, subscribe to the channel and turn on notifications so that you don't miss what's coming in the next part of the series. Thanks for watching today. I'll see you in the next video.